I'm gonna start the Beverly Hills video, but I'm pretty sure I just saw Boston Market.
There it is. Unbelievable. Look at that thing.
Who's going to Boston Market? I don't think I've had it in like 20 years.
What makes this song stink?
How's it going? Pat Finnerty. Welcome back to What Makes This Song Stink. This is episode 3. In this one, we're going to be looking at the iceberg that finally sank the SS Weezer, Beverly Hills.
Gimme.
Song stinks. But before we do, we got to talk about YouTube. I feel like I gained some ground last episode in becoming a YouTube guy. Added another amp in the background, some loose drums, introduced a ring light. I had my first back and forth about music theory in the comments, but you know, watching more YouTube guys, I realized that I'm just not doing enough, man. I also realized that it's real cold in this studio, and if I'm gonna talk about shitty songs, I may as well be comfortable. All right, it's still a little, but you know, this is taking the edge off. But yeah, if I'm gonna get to YouTube, there's still a lot I need to do. One, more amps. I've been watching these YouTube guys, man, it's ridiculous. These guys have more amps than Van Halen in 81. I asked Beato on one of his IG lives, but snub city, so I guess I'm just gonna have to wing it. Now, I don't have a Marshall, but I've got Zach down at Guitar Center.
Hey, Pat, I'm down here at Guitar Center.
So maybe he'll come through with like a Valve Stator or 900, and I could put it right there in the back for no reason for you guys a little later in the video. So we got more amps, but we're not done yet. What do we need next? More lights. I could be Paul McCartney juggling chainsaws, which would be a pretty good thing to see. But if I don't have a light in the background that's not really doing that much, but it's a different color, I don't expect you guys to watch videos. And why should you? You're YouTube viewers, man. You deserve the best. So there's a light in the background now, so you can go ahead and look at that whenever you want. All right, next up, and this one's tough, kind of breaks my heart because I've been shooting all these videos on my phone, feeling real good about it because my phone's in my pocket at all times, pretty convenient. But if I'm ever going to be a real YouTube guy, I think I have to start shooting these videos on an actual camera. You happy now? You can see the cotton in my denim jacket? You see this enormous coffee in 4K? You need that in 4K? Well, that is kind of cool how it zooms right in on there. It focuses right in on the Dunkin'. That's nice. All right, cameras are cool. But I still have to charge it, and I got to get an SD card, and I got to get a bag for the camera, and I got to have it in a bag. And where am I going to get this bag? I don't have a bag. We got more amps, we got more lights, we got an actual camera, so we're done, right? Wrong. There's still one more thing I need to do, and this one's even worse than the camera.
An external microphone. I got this mic clip on right now, and I'm not happy about it, but I gotta admit one thing. I sound beautiful right now. Crisp, clear. When you hear me ragging on Brian Bell, it's gonna come through. 4K, external mics, lights in the back. All right, let's talk about Beverly Hills. This song stinks.
What makes this song stink?
Now this episode's gonna be a little different than the first two, because unlike Kid Rock and Three Doors Down, two acts that I would leave on the side of the road and probably stop to take their water, which is necessary for their survival, Weezer used to be my favorite band for a good portion of my young life. Now I could break this one down section by section and tell you what stinks about it. Like I could tell you that the verse melody could be played on a microwave with a butter knife. Or that the drum part could be played by my girlfriend who's only played the drums twice in her life.
Is that it?
Yeah, that's it.
Or that the bass part could be played by my girlfriend who's never played the bass.
Is that it?
Yeah, that's it.
Or that the guitar solo could be played by my girlfriend who's only been playing guitar for a couple months and has never played a guitar solo.
I don't have a talk box, so the only thing...
Talk box?
It's like a thing that Peter Frampton used to use, but you could get a similar kind of sound with a wah-wah pedal. So even though I know you've never stood up and played guitar, can you try just going like this with your foot? Perfect.
Can't. But we're not gonna do that because I'm a part of this. I loved this band. I defended this band. I thought that they could do no wrong. And now I'm sitting in a room by myself with two huge coffees talking about how they stink. How'd that happen? So in this episode, we're not just gonna break down a song. We're gonna break down my life. In order to do this, I gotta take you guys back. Not to the shack.
Mike, we're cousins, right?
Sure are.
Remember when we really liked Weezer?
Oh, yeah.
13, 14-year-old me, middle school, checking out chicks, don't know what to do, listening to a lot of Nirvana, favorite band, Kurt takes himself out, god damn it, Kurt. I still needed more power chords, more harmonies, more hooks. And then I saw the Sweater Song video, and it had a soft verse and a loud chorus, and there was power chords, and there was harmonies, and there was dogs for no reason, and I was in. Because they were giving us more Kurt, but it was like Kurt light. It was kind of like Kurt on a pogo stick eating combos. Which I don't know the last time I had a combo, and I know that I've never had a combo outside of a car. Never had an indoor combo in my entire life. I don't think I've ever seen a combo in a house. Anyway, the album was 10 for 10, 10 good songs. And then in 96, I'm 16, which, you know, if you do the math now, 96, 16, that means I'm 41, no. No, I mean, why do I care that I'm 41? Yeah, whatever, I'm 41. I mean, I know who's watching this video. I got analytics on YouTube. Wait, hold on. 100%. All right, here you go, boys. So 96, Pinkerton comes out. I put it on, Tired of Sex, first song, and within 3 seconds, I'm blown away. Why? Because it has the In Utero drum sound. Now we're 2 years post-Kurt, god damn it, Kurt, and I'm kind of dealing with it, but at this point in my life, I need more In Utero Albini drum sound than I need hair right now. All right, back to the edge. I mean, it's what we got, you know, it's either that or the guy from Disturbed. So I'm listening to it, and every single song seems to get better. It's got weird chord changes, weird solos, weird lyrics, awesome drum parts, slide guitars, modulations. The chord changes under the solo of The Good Life. The thing was like kind of fucked, but it was amazing. And I'm wearing it out. 10 for 10, I'm wearing this thing out. Well, God bless my parents. I can't believe it how many times they had to listen to Get You. Unreal. I think I owe them an apology or something.
Carrie's usually up here, isn't it?
Yeah, I don't know where the hell it is.
So you guys are my parents, right?
That's right.
Right.
Lucky you.
Do you guys remember when I was in high school?
Yeah.
Yep.
You guys remember when I had hair?
Oh my God, yes.
Oh yeah.
We're just looking at a picture of you last night.
All right. Back from my hair days?
Yes.
I'll be right back.
He's going to get it probably.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
I'm playing a G power chord right there, which means I could have been playing The Good Life. You guys remember when I used to love Weezer?
Yes.
Yeah.
Dad, do you remember me saying Weezer a lot?
Yeah.
And how'd you feel about that? Not good.
I didn't?
You don't like.
Outtakes, B-sides, rarities. I'm buying soundtracks. I bought the Mallrats soundtrack. I bought the Angus soundtrack. I saw Angus in the theater. Tired of Sex became one of my favorite songs, and all I was thinking about was banging. Still am. Can't we just read a book? Right. Now, in between tracking down live versions of Jamie, this is also an exciting time for me and Mike as we start our first high school band. You think we liked Weezer? But I mean, yeah, life was fun, simple. Except, of course, when Mary Grace decided that it'd be better that we were just friends, even though we were going to the prom together. And, you know, it was rumored that she was with Ryan McCann, but we still went to the prom together anyway, and I was a little upset about that, so then I made this face in our picture. Sorry about that, Mary Grace. But yeah, life was great. I was playing shows with my friends. I was going to college next year. Weezer's probably gonna put out a new record. You know, sky's the limit. What could go wrong? Now this is where it starts to get fucking interesting, and this is the most pivotal moment in all of Weezer history. Pinkerton bombs, right? So fans like me and Mike knew that it ruled, but the critics panned it, and it paled in comparison as far as sales go to the Blue Album. And this sent Rivers tailspinning into a dark sea of self-doubt. So he puts the band on hiatus and goes back to Harvard. Wait a second, did I tell you guys about Harvard? Oh shit. Do you know about the Harvard thing? I can't explain the Harvard thing. I'm just gonna have some other guy on YouTube tell you about it.
When the band one day played a show in Boston, he spent some of his time walking around on the campus grounds of Harvard. Pinkerton was released in 96 and received poor reviews across the board.
Wait a second, this guy's got 351,000 views on this fucking video? I set up a green screen for this? This guy sounds like he's in bed.
And so, Rivers went back to Harvard.
Which at first I was just like, bummed that there isn't going to be any Weezer, and I wondered about Harvard, but then I was like, wait a second, I already kind of think this guy's like a mysterious genius, and now he's going to an Ivy League school, so he's got to be a genius, so this is my guy. And you know, I'll just tough it out with no Weezer, but like when it comes back, the next album's going to be amazing. So 98, I went to college too. It was my freshman year at Temple University. And even though there was no Weezer, I was still wearing my shirt 3 to 5 days a week and I was drinking. Not because Weezer broke up, just because I come from a long line of alcoholics. Loved drinking. I was good at it. So there's no Weezer, but it's all right. I got Pavement, I got Guided by Voices, I still got the Beatles, I'm getting into the Kinks, I got a ton of shit, I'm doing all right. Now it's 2000, I'm about 45 pounds heavier, love drinking. And we hear that they're getting back together and playing secret shows under the name Goat Punishment. But Goat Punishment wasn't even playing Weezer songs, they were covering Nirvana albums in full, they were playing Bleach and Incesticide, so it's even more Kurt. God damn it, Kurt. Now why the hell do we need to know this?
Alright, I drove past again and I decided that I gotta stake out this Boston market. I gotta find out how many people are going through this drive-thru. I've been here about 15 minutes and I've seen one car. Not much doing. I've also found out that the old girl can use a rinse. I'm gonna get back to doing Beverly Hills, but I mean, Boston Market, how have they stayed open? My dad used to like it. Did I used to like it?
I also noticed that there's a place across the street called Blinds to Go, where I guess you can get your blinds there and...
leave?
Dude from Blinds to Go.
That's me.
What do you think about the song Beverly Hills by Weezer?
Not a good one.
There's a Boston Market across the street. How often are you guys hitting that thing?
You know, not as much these days. The B-Mart kind of fell off, but...
Do you think the B-Mart could come back?
They got a tough road ahead of them.
Tough road ahead of them. Fucking love that guy. Okay, cool. What was I talking about? Bitching about something. The Green album, how long we had to wait? Yeah, how long we had to wait for the Green album. It took like 5 years. 5 years! 5 fucking years we waited for a Weezer album. 5 years of Bush, Puddle of Mud, Stained, Korn, Creed, Matchbox 20. The point is that the anticipation for this album was unrivaled. It was growing and growing and growing, making its release the most significant thing that happens in 2001. Making its release the second most significant thing that happens in 2001.
Remember when we went to go get the Green album at like midnight the day it came out?
Joe Nardone's Gallery
of Sound. Gallery of Sound. And then do you remember when one of us, I'm not sure who it was, threw that CD out of the window of the car?
Oh, that would happen.
Like a week later? Yeah.
Now, did it sink the SS Weezer? No, but it put a big fucking hole in the hull. Because it was compressed and lifeless, and all the guitar solos were the melodies. Halfway through this thing, I'm thinking, like, what's that shit about Harvard? They teach you how to write crab? Go Dogs. But if they stopped right there, I wouldn't have done a What Makes This Song Stink on any of those songs, because it was still kind of like Weezer. Maybe crab. Now I'm speculating here, but in that hole could have quite possibly been the first time that two people got together and talked about the difference between the Blue Album Pinkerton and everything else. Also known as the Weezer Conversation. Now I could get into this, Saturday Night Live did a sketch, there's a million YouTube videos about it. If you're a Weezer fan, you know what I'm talking about. But luckily, in an attempt to stop talking about this, I actually wrote a song called the Weezer Conversation, like 5 years ago. I can't believe this thing's actually paying off.
Yes, the Blue Album was real good, and Pinkerton was a staple. You were young, they were good, wrap it up, the Weezer Conversation.
Do you think that they were good or that you were young?
I think a little bit of both, but I also think that, you know, seeing what they've done with the subsequent 25 years really went precipitously down on the interest level.
So the Green Album stinks, but it goes platinum, which tells Rivers that, you know what, you're doing the right thing. Keep it clean, essentially put out a Weezer Eagles album, and it's gonna work out. Don Henley probably likes the Green Album, I would imagine, and remember what Don Henley is, an asshole. Now it's 2002, and I'm working at Blockbuster. Tough times. And like my hairline, Weezer's holding on by a thread. They have one more chance though. The new album's coming out and it's called Maladroit, which means clumsy. So we're like, all right, maybe it's gonna sound like Pinkerton. Now, I don't know if I bought it the night it came out, but I know that I got it pretty early. I gotta check with Mike.
We tried Maladroit though, didn't we?
Sure.
I mean, it was better than the Green Album, but Dope Nose? I mean, at least they're giving us a James Gang riff over the Eagles. And this might be a little on the Dope Nose, but when I heard this song, I'm walking away. Still wasn't anywhere close to Blue Album or Pinkerton. It just didn't have any of those unique qualities that those albums had. And because of that, the t-shirt is now on the way to a Salvation Army.
Aren't we supposed to go to the Salvation Army?
Can we just tell them we did?
Yeah, fuck it.
And the iceberg is broken off the glacier, and the SS Weezer is on a direct course. So now we're finally getting to why you probably clicked on this video, 2005 make-believe. Now, even though I don't remember a lot about 2005, love drinking, I do remember that this is the first time I said, fuck Weezer. This is the one that made it personal. Because me and Mike's band, OK Patty, was still getting compared to Weezer. And we should have in the beginning, but at this point, I feel like we were putting out cooler shit than they were.
You love it, don't say it, don't. I'm just spinning my wheels. I'm swooning, you're booning, you're losing me. You're losing me, you're losing me. You're losing me, you're losing me. You're losing me.
So then when Beverly Hills comes out and your band is associated with that, you know, rough, and people are coming up to me and they're saying, like, what do you think of the new song? And I'm just like, I don't know, man, I'm listening to Zuma. Now, people have been asking the question, what the fuck happened to Weezer, for a real long time. I'm far from the first, but I might be the first that actually has the answer. And it's Beverly Hills. Because what is Beverly Hills? It's a mid-tempo 145, Beato. What are the good Weezer songs like that? The Sweater Song, and El Scorcho. I've always thought about Beverly Hills as kind of being like the evil El Scorcho, or if like the sweater in the Sweater Song had an NRA patch on it. Good joke, but I'm serious. I'm gonna sing El Scorcho and the Sweater Song over Beverly Hills, and I'm gonna sing Beverly Hills over El Scorcho and the Sweater Song. Mash up, mash pipe, it was there. And I think that once we do this, we're gonna be able to identify whether it's the music, the lyrics, or the production that makes everything else Weezer stink. Now, I'm thinking it's a combination of all of them, but I'm not sure. It's probably a combination of all of them.
Combination of all of them.
Combination of all of them.
Definitely a combination of all of them.
Now, you're probably also wondering, why are you whispering right now? I don't know. All right, this sucks, but first up, we got Beverly Hills, and I'm singing it over the El Scorcho track, Tough Stuff. Let's see what happens.
Zach! Pat, check it out. Is that what I think it is?
It's a Marshall.
That's a fucking Marshall. I got a Marshall. I'm Beato.
This is gonna really rake in the subscribers for you.
That's I'm not gonna plug it in. I don't need that at all, but it looks good.
This is good news.
Where I come from isn't all that great. My automobile is a piece of crap. Where I come from isn't all that great. My automobile is a piece of crap. My fashion sense is a little whack, and my friends are just as screwy as me.
Amazing. The El Scorcho track sounds so good that the boring one-note melody of Beverly Hills doesn't really bother me. Because it's got like cool stuff like the turnaround, like... That alone is better than Beverly Hills. Just the turnaround in El Scorcho. I mean, the chorus still stinks, but like, again, the track sounds so good and it rocks and the drum sounds awesome. So it's like, it almost takes away the fact that the guy wishes that he lived in Beverly Hills when he lives in Santa Monica. Okay, so now let's flip it and sing El Scorcho over the Beverly Hills track. See what that sounds like.
Goddamn, you have Japanese girls. You do it to me every time. Oh, the redhead said you shred the cello, and I'm cello, baby.
This stinks. Scorcho ain't saving that, man. In fact, that's a red lighter. This is Mordor shit, man. It only took one El Scorcho over Beverly Hills to identify the culprit, and I'm pretty sure it's the music, which is hard to believe because the lyrics stink. All right, next up, we got the Sweater Song over El Scorcho, and I don't think this one's gonna get us out of the red. Also, I'm pretty sure I recorded this song somewhere outside of the studio to distract myself from the Beverly Hills track. I don't know where I was, but I'm pretty sure I wasn't here.
Goddamn, I can't.
I don't care how many dogs are in the video. If this is what I heard in 94, I was waiting for the Goo Goo Dolls to come on. This thing sounds like a Kidz Bop version of We Will Rock You.
Gimme, gimme.
But you're a young man, hormone shown on the street. Gotta take on the world.
Gimme, gimme.
And seeing that I've got the Strat here, hey baby,
we might as well put it to work and see if the cool El Scorcho solo can save this unbelievably boring track. Now we gotta do the Beverly Hills Battle of the Band solo over the El Scorcho track. This one's gonna break my heart. That was actually kind of fun, but it still sounds better though, because it doesn't have the Beverly Hills track. Jesus fucking Christ, this guy wrote Across the Sea. I guess this is a good time to talk about Matt Sharp too. I mean, people always say like, you know, the band changed after Matt Sharp left. It was all Matt Sharp. And like, listen, I love Return of the Rentals and Half of Seven More Minutes just as much as you. And I think he supplied the band with a unique energy that they've been missing. But I mean, let's be real. I don't think a high falsetto is gonna save this fucking song.
Imagine senses a little weak and my friends are just as sweet as me.
And while we're at it, we may as well try it over I Love Rock and Roll, because it is I Love Rock and Roll.
Didn't go to morning schools. Preppy girls never looked at me. Why should they? I got nothing in my pocket. Beverly Hills, that's where I wanna be. Living in Beverly Hills. Hills.
Throwing that extra hills in the end. It's becoming astoundingly clear that the music is the worst part of this song. In fact, I'm starting to think that you could sing this song over any song but Beverly Hills and it will sound better. Any song? No, not that song. I mean, could it? No, not that song.
Sign it up! Didn't go to boarding schools. Preppy girls never looked at me. Why should they? I ain't nobody. Got nothing in my pocket. Sign it up! Beverly Hills.
Now I was putting this one off, but it's finally time to sing the Bad Bad Beverly Hills over the sweater song. I'm gonna need a coffee for this one.
I didn't go to boarding schools. Preppy girls never looked at me. Why should they? I ain't nobody. Got nothing in my pocket. Beverly Hills, that's where I wanna be. Living in Beverly Hills.
This is fucked up. That should never be played again. That absolutely should never be played again. That is wrong what just happened right there. And I'll tell you why. Because the sweater song is everything that's great about Weezer. It's innocent, it's pure, it's stupid, but it's the good kind of stupid. It's goddamn I am. And then in Beverly Hills, he comes around and sings about how his friends are just as screwy as he is. So in essence, he's telling us that he's screwy, right? So like in 2005, he's saying like, I'm screwy. But in 1994, like he actually was screwy. You know, like the sweater song was a screwy song. You just didn't have to tell us that. God damn it, I'm pissed. And listen, I know I'm being tough on the guy and I don't want to be a dick and who the hell am I? But I also know that he's writing a commentary on celebrity culture about some guy that doesn't have any money in his pockets that wishes he was a rock star from California when he's a millionaire that's a rock star from California. I mean, Jesus Christ, this is like if Bruce wrote a song about wishing he lived in New Jersey.
I wish I was from New Jersey. I'd never have to pump my own gas.
Speaking of Bruce, I mean, I do live in Philadelphia. I got a lot of thinking to do.
Listen to Beverly Hills, man, did it stink? I took a walk, now starting to think. Was the band ever good? It's the same people who named the album Ratitude. I didn't even talk about the gimme, gimme.
All right, here's where we're at. For the first time in What Makes This Song Stink history, I'm experiencing guilt. And it's because I got a fucked up relationship with Weezer, man. It's like kind of like a better man situation. Even though I know Beverly Hills stinks, and I know that they recorded and continue to perform a very accurate and unnecessary version of Toto's Africa. Why did they do that? Toto's version is doing fine. No, I do. I have a level of guilt because it's that old fan part of me, you know? And they're not here to defend themselves.
You know, I'm not getting Cuomo, Bell, Wilson, or Schreiner to come on to What Makes the Song Stink. You know, so how are they going to defend themselves? The best thing I came up with is a guy in a tribute band.
Ed, cool. You are a lead singer in a Weezer tribute band. Is that correct?
Yes, yes.
How can you defend Beverly Hills?
I know that there's a big part of me that likes that song a lot just because that was kind of the first album where I was around like, oh my God, this is coming out. Oh my God, I think they released the track listing. Oh my God, you know.
It was your record. This is, okay, so this is something here, Ed. So how old were you when that album came out?
16 or something like that, 15,
this
16.
Is,
yeah.
Okay, so this is where I'm going here with this, man. I was 16 when Pinkerton came out.
How you were introduced to that band and, you know, what the memories that it was tied to. I just have a lot of respect for everything that they've done, even if it's not what I am drawn to 100% of the time.
Even if it's on Hurley?
Yeah, even if it's on Hurley.
They named an album after a Lost character, Ed.
I wish they didn't make the picture of her. I wish that wasn't the album cover.
Let's talk about Beverly Hills, Ed. It's like, if you're giving me sweater song changes, man, you got to do better than this.
Now, if you're trying to have somebody justify Beverly Hills critically, it's hard, but I think at the end of the day, it's just, you know, I think it's just a good pop song, and I like pop songs, you know. It's just a simple pop song. I think that they needed a song like that, and I don't know, it's easy to sing along to me. That's enough. I love Weezer. I want them to always be releasing top tier stuff, but for me personally,
yeah,
it's enough.
But I mean, like, that can make me cry.
Yeah.
You know?
But again, though, man, it's kind of like a magic time, like what we first started talking about. Can you recreate that?
This is a fucking wild ride, man. I mean, I was ready to toss it all out. I was ready to say, see you later, Blue Pinkerton. I'm done with it all. And then I talked to Ed, and he's got me, like, rethinking Pacific Daydream. I feel weird, man. I don't know. Maybe some coffee. I'm out of coffee. What else can I do? More amps? All right, so they're kind of smoothing me out a little bit, but I still feel like off, you know? So I think I'm going to have to do what I used to do back in my drinking days after a 3-day blackout bender. Call back my parents.
Right, Mom, get in the shot. God damn it.
We're not? All right, where are you?
Well, there you go. Yeah, now you are. Bands might put out bad albums, but they don't offend you. Like, they put out albums that offended the fans.
I would liken it to, like, the Beach Boys and Kokomo.
Sure.
You know, like,
that's brutal.
Like, the Beach Boys were fabulous. They were fantastic. Everybody knows that. But then they went and did that shit and it stunk.
Hey, Dad, real quick, on my ride over here today, I saw I drove past a Boston Market.
I love Boston Market.
You used to send me up there anytime that Mom was.
You'd fly to Heartbeat for one of those.
I think it was good, right?
I loved them.
Okay.
I think Anna loved them too.
What?
Boston
Market.
Remember those chicken dinners and stuff like that?
I love
that
place.
Anna loved them too.
All right.
Right.
Count me out. Yeah.
So we're back at the board for no reason, which means the video's over. And I need it to be, because this took me on a ride, man. Jesus Christ. But I think I finally answered the question, what the fuck happened to Weezer? Time. They lost the moment, you know? There's moments in this life, and some of them are very fleeting. And I think that pocket of time was a very special time, for not just only for the band, but for me, you know? And as life goes on, their albums became boring and compressed. And as life goes on for us, it kind of becomes boring and compressed. And don't get me wrong, I love my life, but I like my life. I'm as moderately happy as a conscious 41-year-old could be on this insane planet where there's racial injustice, a mass shooting's probably happening right now, and we're going to be underwater in 10 years. But just like the Beverly Hills guitar solo, life kind of becomes predictable when you're an adult. you kind of know what's going to happen. It's like you're going to get tired. You're going to want to go home. But back then, you didn't always want to go home. And you didn't know what was going to happen. And I think what I learned the most in making this video is that I just miss being a kid sometimes. You know, I'm never going to listen to Teal album or the Black album or the Red album or Maladroit or Ratitude or Hurley or the one with the long acronym or Pacific Daydream. Maybe I should listen to Pacific Daydream. Any friend of Diane's is a friend of mine. I'm never going to listen to Pacific Daydream, but I don't have to because they gave me what they had to give me. The Blue album in Pinkerton. You know, I always worry about being like a Glory Days guy. It's like sitting on the bar like, you know, I have 15 tackles against Lakeland in the 91 quarterfinal. You know, I'm always worried about that. So I've like kind of cut off Weezer and I haven't listened to those songs in like 15 years. But, you know, like my parents were saying about Kokomo, like it doesn't wipe out In My Room or Good Vibrations or God Only Knows or Surfer Girl. And Tug of War doesn't take out Ram, you know? So I need to forgive Weezer. Because they're making people happy, like Ed, you know? And happiness is hard to find in this life. And maybe Beverly Hills connects somebody to that magic time like Why Bother does for me. Because that's what it was. And I loved Weezer. And I miss my friends. And I miss driving around with Mike after school, blasting Pinkerton. Getting our first drum kit, and taking it up to the attic, and like figuring out Nirvana songs and writing our own first songs. I miss getting Boston Market for my dad.
I used Fly to Heartbeat for one of those.
And I did love Boston Market.
They got a tough road ahead of them.
I loved Weezer.
They got a tough road ahead of them.
Can you recreate that?
I used Fly to Heartbeat for one of those.
Can you recreate that?
Not that bad.
Holds up.
Beverly Hills still stinks.
Oh yeah.
Thanks for watching. Don't click the link below.
What makes this song stink?
There is a bit of bad news. Check Instagram Live. Beato.
Beato's live right now?
Yeah.
What's going on? Oh my god.
Pedal wall.
He's got pedals behind him.
Amps and pedals. So.
Pedals now.
Yeah.
So now I got pedals behind me?
Yeah. Boutique.
Yeah, do you have a lot of pedals?
I don't.
All right, pedals it is.